It all began here, at 33 Addicott Road in Weston-super-Mare, in 1945, when Richie Blackmore was born. He would go on not only to write one of rock's most famous riffs, but to explore a number of musical forms, including Bach, classical symphonic rock, hard rock, blues, and medieval ballads. Richie was interested in the guitar from an early age, but his father insisted he took proper lessons.
My father insisted I went to music lessons when I was 11. And he said to me at the time, he said, if you don't learn this properly, I'm going to put it across your head. I used to cycle about 4 miles to the guy who was teaching me. And I'd often fall off my bike.
Throughout his life, Richie has been the object of much criticism, adulation and speculation. But until now, he has never given the world his take on his story. A story with more than its fair share of tantrums, breakups, rivalries and rows.
He was such an advanced musician, way ahead of his time. Way, way ahead.
He's a fireball. You know, he really is. He's beyond belief. His technique is incredible. Where did that come from? I have no idea. And this is before Hendrix, you know, so Richie really is a great originator and creator of the wild electric guitar.
The way he holds the guitar and everything, that's, you know, sort of ingrained in my mind as that's what a cool guitar player is supposed to look like. That's how they're supposed to behave.
In a lot of ways, it's a little tragic that Richie didn't stand up and shine the light on himself, which is why I'm happy to be here. He needs the light right on him, because unlike many people, he actually deserves it.
It's like a sword, almost, like a clean, sharp sword that weighs a real lot, you know? His precision when he plays was stunning.
A true pioneer, as somebody who was truly unique and original.
To me, he was like the Caucasian Hendrix.
It actually changed my life. It was my first gig ever. We got right up against the stage, right in front of Richie. He came out, and Purple came out, and he just blew me away. It was way more than I expected. It was just a lot. And, you know, after that, I was, like, dazed. I went home to my mum and dad. I said, I need a guitar. I have to have a guitar.
He is measured, he is thoughtful, he knows the value of clear space, of daylight between the notes. It's not all about... It's about phrasing, it's about time, it's about that the spaces are as important as the notes that they separate.
It's a mystery. I still find Richie Blackmore a complete mystery. It's also a mystery that people don't talk about him that much. It's odd because he is absolutely there as one of the pioneers.
The pioneering Richie was single-minded from an early age.
I won't do what I'm told to do. And that seems to go back to when I was 5. I've seen pictures of me at 5 and I remember distinctly my mother saying, smile for the cameraman. I'm going, no. And I felt a resentment to the cameraman. Why do you need, and I used to say to my mother, why do you need a picture of me? She goes, because to remember you, you're fine. Well, I'm here now. And I couldn't understand the principle. There's something in there psychologically. Why was I so uptight at the age of 5?
But before he was in his teens, Richie made a promise to himself to be the best there was, whatever it took.
I was such a poor pupil, and I was always near the bottom of class in my tests. I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to excel in music on the guitar. So they go, well, he was a terrible pupil, but he's a really good guitar player. And I had that thought in my head ever since I was 12 onwards. Well, he doesn't know anything, but he can really play the guitar. And I always wanted the teachers to say that.
From the age of 18, Richie worked with producer Joe Meek as a session musician in London and toured with Screaming Lord Sutch. And later with Gene Vincent and Jerry Lee Lewis, until the gigs dried up in 1968.
I was working in a dry cleaners. I had about 16 telegrams from Chris Curtis, who was in the band The Searchers, who I'd met in Hamburg. And he really liked my playing. And he said, I have a backer. I want you to come to England. We're going to start a band. You're going to play second guitar. Went, okay. Who's playing first guitar? I am. Chris Curtis. Oh, okay, good. Who's playing drums then? Because he's a drummer. He said, I'm playing drums. Bass? He goes, I'm bass player. I went, yeah, I kind of thought that was going to happen. I said, is there anybody else in this band? He said, we have a keyboard player, John Long.
It was the start of a partnership that would last for 25 years.
We played together for a little bit. I realized how good he was, and it was mutual. And I said, I can get a brilliant drummer. And John said, well, I know a really good bass player. That was Nick Simper. And so we just needed a singer.
They took on Rod Evans as vocalist, and Chris Curtis soon dropped out to be replaced by Ian Pace on drums. All they needed now was a name.
John put in Orpheus. The drummer put in The Hill. And I put in Deep Purple, just because of the song, Deep Purple. Grandmother used to play it on the piano, and they seemed to like that. In those days, you have to have a double-barreled name. You know, the Moody Blues, Pink Floyd, Deep Purple.
It was a name that would become synonymous with British hard rock and launch the career of Richie Blackmore.
We did the usual going away to a cottage in the country, which was the in thing to do at the time, the proverbial cottage, you know, practicing. Thieves Hall, I think it was called, and it was haunted. It had to be haunted. And we made that record, the first one, in 24 hours. We did it in 2 days, the whole thing.
And while it wasn't an amazing record in its own right, you did get struck by the fact there are times on that record when Richie Blackmore's guitar performances were different to anything else. They weren't a copy of Hendrix, even though you could hear little bits of notations that maybe led towards Hendrix. They weren't a copy of anybody else. They were influenced by, yet taking its own direction. You had a classical feel, a baroque feel, and a rock and roll feel.
Some tracks also had a distinctly pop feel, and it was a cover of a Joe South song, Hush, which launched the band in the USA. Back in England, Richie heard Robert Plant singing.
There was a place called Mother's in Birmingham. Robert's there singing, and I'm going, my God, who's this? He's an amazing singer. You know, he had the range, the voice, and the look. That's when I decided we have to get someone who could belt it out, you know, and project. You know. And that's when we got Ian going. As soon as I heard him scream, I went, that's the guy for us. He looked like Jim Morrison, which I knew that would go down well, you know. So we have someone who looks like Jim Morrison who can scream like Arthur Brown and Edgar Winter.
That scream was his identity.
In came Ian Gillan and his scream, and new bassist Roger Glover, and out went Evans and Simper. Ritchie was now lead guitar in what was to become the classic Deep Purple lineup.
It became, I suppose, obvious to all of us that they were not just another flash in the pan pop rock band, but there was something more of substance.
And Ritchie was a figure of mystery and wonder already. You know, Ritchie Blackmore was something incredible. I mean, nobody could play like that in those days. No, it's not just speed, you know, there's a lot of people who can play fast, you know, now, but they can't be Richie Blackmore.
He plays right on the money and leaves enough space to allow the music to breathe and the listener to become enveloped in the whole atmosphere of what's being performed and created and generated.
I went through a period of shredding and thinking that everything revolved around speed. And now I go, it really doesn't mean anything. It's good to be fast now and again, but you have to say something thoughtful. You can't just go, look at me. Am I not great?
Ritchie will take you on a couple of hours' journey of guitar playing, which will cover a lot more ground. It's not just like, you know, tipping a pot of multicolored paint over somebody. This is about drawing people into your dark, mysterious web.
But while Ritchie was keen to develop Deep Purple as a rock band, his co-founder John Lord had other ambitions.
John Lord was inspired to write a concerto for group and orchestra, and it was a big challenging venture. The band The Nice had previously recorded with orchestras and had classical aspirations, but John Lord wanted to write a really sort of important piece that would include the group with an orchestra in a kind of artistic way, a way that would work effectively. And they tried it out at the Royal Albert Hall, and it was a big success, a big challenge.
You can see Ritchie in the video for the Albert Hall concert, and he plays great, you know, but you can feel he's very constrained. He's sort of itching to break out somewhere. He has this edge to him which is indefinable and not quite tameable.
The first record we did I thought was not bad. The two after that were lacking in direction. We were going in the studio with really no ideas because we were on the road all the time. It wasn't till we did the concerto with John and the orchestra, and I said, I really don't want to play with orchestras anymore. Let's do a rock and roll record. I said, John, you know, we'll do the whole thing as a rock and roll record, and if it doesn't work, we'll play with orchestras the rest of our lives. So he said, yeah, that sounds fair. You had Zeppelin start in Black Sabbath. Everybody was hitting with hard rock. Gave me an idea of to play the hard rock stuff. I was very going through a kind of an angry, uptight, come on, let's get on with it. You know, I'd had enough of playing with orchestras and everything being, you know, wishy-washy.
The wishy-washy orchestra versus hard rock debate was resolved when the band wrote and recorded Black Knight, and it went to number 2 in the UK charts.
We were in the studio doing Deep Purple and Rock, and the management came in and amazing, you know, these people that go, you know what you need is a hit record. And you go, I never thought of that. A hit record, yeah. And I started playing, I just started playing.
okay, let's have a verse. Put a verse in there. And we did that very quickly. Very quickly. And all of a sudden, of course, that went to number one, or number two, number one. It was funny how it was written like that, very quickly. And that's the best way to write a song. And that is based on... Ricky Nelson put out a tune called Summertime in 1958. Which, you know, he's singing Summertime, Summertime. And the living is easy, you know. That was the bass riff. The top line was... Add that. So right there, you've got two hit records. Because if you go... Hey, Joe. So as soon as I heard Hendrix play that intro... I got that from the same record that we got the bass riff from.
Band were on a roll, and in 1970 their fourth album, Deep Purple in Rock, reached number four in the UK charts and went gold in Britain and America.
I just knew that I was happy with it at the time, because the previous three, I thought, we don't know where we're going. We're dilly-dallying, we're going all over the place. Ballads, bit of blues, folk, it was like mishmash. People like to get a record and put it on and go... I can leave that on and it's party time.
Well, the Deep Purple in Rock, of course, was the definitive album, I think, for Deep Purple. It was the era of Black Sabbath, of course, and Led Zeppelin. So to see Deep Purple really focus and get down to it on their rock album, that was really convinced the vast mass of their fans. And really, for the first time, Deep Purple became like among the top three British bands.
I think what really inspired me more than anything else was the In Rock album. But it was the fire and it was the passion that really spoke, and that was the bit I wanted to bottle and keep.
When you hear Speaking, you're looking at really proto-thrash, proto-metal. This was so influential in what came later in metal terms, and was really Blackmore delivering a dynamic riff on which Gillan held his vocals and which Lord played off with keyboard. And Child in Time is just phenomenal. It's a remarkable piece of epic music. It's a story. It's almost biblical in the way it reaches out and envelops you. This was a classical piece of music. It's a performance by a band on an orchestral level.
With the pressure on to follow up the success of Deep Purple in Rock, Richie and the band once again locked themselves away from the world to write.
We'd rented this old dilapidated house down in Devon. And everybody had their bedroom. And mine was full of flies and it was a dreadful place, but it had a good vibe to it. So we were into doing lots of seances at the time.
And I always felt that to do a seance, the best thing was to have a cross, you know, because it was in the early days when I kind of believed in that, and that was a form of protection. Of course, I didn't have a cross on me. And I went up to John Lord's wife. I said, "Do you have a cross I could borrow?" She said, "I'm Jewish." So it didn't go down too well. So I went, "Roger, Roger will have a cross." And I went to his bedroom outside. He'd gone to sleep. "Roger, what? You have a cross?" "Yeah, I need the cross. We're doing a seance." "No, leave me alone." So, you know, I got this axe. So I just went crash, crash at the door. And it kind of made a hole. Now I'm axing the door down, you know, and I got through the hole, you know. Went over to him, "I want your cross. Guy, get off, get off."
Roger's a very gentle man. Violence doesn't often occur to him as a means to anything. It was very un-Roger-like, what followed, you know, Roger chasing Richie around the house with said axe. You know, like, "Roger, wow." So that was a lot of fun. There once was a woman, a strange kind of woman,
the kind that gets written down in history. In 1971, they released a new single, Strange Kind of Woman, and a follow-up to their landmark Deep Purple in Rock, the album Fireball.
It was great, yeah, because all of a sudden, you know, starving for a few years before that, and we were suddenly in vogue, and everybody had Deep Purple in Rock until we replaced it with Fireball. Fireball was put together too quickly, for my liking. We didn't have the ideas. Fireball, to me, was artificial, contrived.
Despite Richie's misgivings, Fireball reached number one on the UK charts, and the band set to work on what would be their third album, Machine Head.
Machine Head, I have great memories of. We did that in the Swiss Alps, and that was fantastic. And we did it in 3 weeks, and the ideas were just flowing. I had written a few things in my time off, so I had those, like Highway Star. I'd written the solo basically at home, worked it out, which I'd never done before. It was always on the fly, as they were, you know, just jamming. So we had a lot of constructive ideas. Roger Glover had written Maybe I'm a Leo, which I thought was a great tune.
They were due to record in the casino, which was then the main concert venue in Montreux. But the evening before they were due to start, a fire ignited during a Frank Zappa concert, burning it to the ground. Festival organiser Claude Nobbs came to their rescue.
Claude, with enormous selflessness, said, "Don't worry, I'll help you find somewhere else to record." Where? You know, anyway, so there was this amazing Victorian glass-walled pavilion in some gardens, some lovely lakeside gardens. And with enormous disregard for anyone who might live within, you know, 10 or 12 miles of it, we set up in there, you know. It was a very ill-chosen place, but it was a stopgap.
The recording session was back on track.
Richie was astonishingly prolific with guitar riffs, profligate almost. You know, they would just tumble out of him, and that was heaven, absolute heaven for a band. You know, because he was a guitarist who just would never tread, it seemed, the same road twice.
And it was the fire that had destroyed their original recording venue that was to inspire the song that contains one of rock's greatest riffs.
When we got back to the hotel, there was we looked out of the window. I think we were at Stiff Branders or something. We looked out of the window, and you could actually see the smoke from the casino coming across the lake, this big billowing cloud coming across the lake, hence the title Smoke on the Water. The boys came up with that.
Well, the first time I heard Smoke on the Water, of course, from Machine Head, it was one of those riffs that hit you right away. It's a bit like Sunshine of Your Love by Cream, or, you know, Whole Lot of Love by Led Zeppelin. It was just, I don't know where guitarists find these riffs from, actually.
When we did Smoke on the Water, it was just Ian and myself, Pacey and myself,
I said, what rhythm haven't we played? And he went, he laid that down. So I just went, and that's where we were. You know. The next minute, the police were knocking at the door because we were making so much racket. And we knew it was the police. So we said, let's go for a take before they throw us out of here.
Every guitar player dreams of doing with its creators. Every kid who ever picked up a guitar can go ding, ding, ding. The funny thing is they all do it different. That's the nice thing. And I found that I had it in my head how to play it. It was completely different to the way Richie plays it.
Somebody said that music, you know, has many different colors. And one of those colors is silence, simplicity. The quiet parts, the easy parts, the parts you can immediately grasp onto and wonder why you didn't write it yourself. That's genius. That's a genius riff. Wish I'd wrote it.
The second record I ever bought in my life was Machine Head. What an album. Oh my God. To have a record like that and to have a guitar player like Richie in your radar and your field, it was just the greatest. You just think, what would my life have been like without that?
The way Richie plays the riff is not the way that two generations of kids have played it in the guitar shop, you know, and driven people mad to the point where in some shops in London it says, you know, if you're trying out a guitar, please don't play Smoke on the Water, you know.
Well, the first guitar, that guitar right over there, you see the strap with the maple body? That was my first real guitar, and I got it because of the poster on my wall in my bedroom of Richie playing. It was that guitar, and that's what I wanted. I wanted the Richie Blackmore Strat.
Richie's solo on Machine Head's Highway Star was also set to become a Deep Purple staple.
Highway Star is, that's crazy. That's just a crazy song for a guitar player. It makes everyone who thinks they're a guitar player need to pick up their guitar and see, well, if I'm that good, can I do that?
Highway Star solo was one of the first things I could get my head around. Even when I was like 16 or 17, wasn't the standard notes you'd use. It wasn't just the blues scale. It was, you know, it was classically, there was classical stuff coming in there. And with this aggression, you know.
Richie was really looking to expand on his solos and wanted a particular sequence, which is actually almost a classical sequence. It's probably the defining moment for Richie's soloing, Highway Star, to me. It's the most recognizable solo. I like solos where you know them, you know. Solos where it's just a nothing. So I think Highway Star was just stunning for that effect.
American players always go right to the edge of the cliff and fall off and wave as they're going down. But the British players seem to take that one half a step back from the cliff, and so it's together right to the end of the song, but it's still extremely thrilling. And the funny thing about that song is that having played it, you can get carried away with the emotion of the song, the intensity of it, of what you're doing, and it ruins it in a way. And that's part of Richie's charm for me, is his restraint at the right moments, and it creates a lot of drama in his parts.
It was a game changer. I thought Machine Head was a game changer myself.
Machine Head reached number 7 and went double platinum in the USA and gold at number 1 in the UK. But Richie's desire to control events was now leading to clashes with vocalist Ian Gillan.
He was, as they say, an alpha guy, so was I. He wanted to control, I wanted to control. So we butted heads because of that. You know, we still respected each other, but we never got on. And we just couldn't be in the same room. That was the problem. I wasn't speaking to him. He wasn't speaking to me. We weren't being creative.
The band then toured Japan, which produced their hugely successful 1972 live album, Made in Japan. But things were coming to a head with Ian Gillan.
I think it started with coming back on the Japanese flight. Paul Rogers, you know, to me was just mind-blowing, his voice. I wanted Ian to be able to do that, and I couldn't relate to Ian screaming and yelling and that Elvis Presley impersonation. He said, so how do you want me to sing? I'll sing any way you want me to sing. And I went, Ian, you can't sing that way. That's a blues thing, you know? And I think after that, that turned him off. Like, he was rejected. So we went downhill from there.
The aptly titled Who Do We Think We Are was to be the final album before Ian Gillan and Roger Glover left the band.
I think Richie Blackmore spent a lot of his career looking for the perfect lineup, and when he found it, he still wasn't happy with it.
We started looking for other people. We found Glenn Hughes, and they'd have covered him.
I'd left art college, and I was working in a boutique in Redcar in the north of England, and I read in the Melody Maker that there was a picture of John at his organ, very Monty Python, saying, Deep Purple still haven't found a singer and are considering unknowns, which was basically a little ding moment.
Basie played me this tape. He said, what do you think of this singer? And it was Dave Coverdale. And John would go, well, what's wrong with him? And I go, well, you can't have him after Gillan. I mean, Gillan was this god with the women, and we've got to have someone that can fire up the female interest there. And they said, oh, no, we disagree. You know, the girls in the office think he's cute. I'm going, cute, okay. We did Mistreated, which is the bluesy thing, and we had that voice, Paul Rogers kind of overturned to it. And Burn itself, the song, worked. I felt that we had some good songs there. Straight into blaze, the spark on fire, woman's flame to reach and higher. We were fools, we called a liar. It's Burn. Of course, Glenn was very effervescent. He had a great funky way of playing the bass. He was a very rhythmic bass player. You didn't believe the words of his words. He said, once a boy, you'll never learn. When I leave, there's no return. The people laugh, so she said, burn. Because before that, we had more of a bom 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 bom. Glenn was more bom 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 bom. There would be this rhythmic. He's very good with his rhythmic syncopation. Yeah.
You know, it bears noting that for me, Richie Blackmore, unlike many guitar players, never lost his edge, if it were. Byrne is every bit as important as Space Truck and some of the later stuff. You can actually hear a guitar player at the top of his game.
Richie is convinced that the clock in his bar is haunted and chimes whenever it is happy.
Very happy.
So it doesn't do it at a set time, really?
No. Only when it's happy. It'll stay off for months. It's haunted. It was given to me by a friend.
Richie's lifelong interest in haunting and practical jokes was something else newcomer Coverdale had to get used to.
Some of them were very close to the knuckle. We were at Clearwell Castle in Gloucestershire, Forest of Dean. A guy called Tony Ashton was coming down from London for the weekend for the hang, you know. So Richie and I had the crew empty the guest bedroom of all the furniture and took up the carpets, took up the floorboards and put a huge speaker, I mean a really big Marshall speaker underneath the bed. Put the boards back in, put the carpets back over, everything, you know, just looking normal. Fed the wires down to another room down the way and set up and waited for Tony Ashton to come back from the pub. And as we hear the steps coming down the corridor and Tony's door closed. Right? So we give him time to bathroom and whatever and get into bed. And then we turned the speaker, the microphone on. And I went up, started scratching against a board, which you can imagine this is under a bed, and saying, "Let me out." Well, we heard the most unearthly scream and panicky footsteps running down the corridor. It certainly wasn't a guy's voice. Tony was still at the pub. This was a guest of the family who owned the castle, who'd actually come back from Bristol after seeing the Exorcist movie. So, I mean, and was last seen heading, you know, into the deep dark forest. He has no boundaries when he comes to his pranks, his japes.
This is Ontario, 40 miles east of Los Angeles. The only sounds you'll hear today are the railway track to the south and the highway to the north. But the 40,000 plus people who gathered here for the 1974 Cow Jam Festival were about to witness Richie at his most theatrical.
Ah, Cow Jam. It was pretty romantic when it happened, I'll tell you. It was. I remember a beautiful Southern California day.
I'd come from driving in little transit vans, local gigs, into flying in a customized private 707, 727, the Starship, you know, which is how we flew into that environment. It was breathtaking to me.
There must have been 350,000 people there. I think 100,000 burned the fence down, and so there was probably 350,000. When we look at, you know, the visual images from above, you can't imagine what it's like to walk onto a stage and you can't see, or you can see the skyline, but in the skyline there's people.
It really was stunning.
There was a whole host of Emerson, Lake and Palmer and Black Sabbath, Earth, Wind and Fire, Seals and Croft, Black Oak, Arkansas, and Rare Earth, I think that was the bill. And we were offered the headline slot.
John Colessa, the management, called me up 6 months before that festival and said, "They want you to do a California Jam." I said, "No thanks, I'm not interested in any more festivals. They're a nightmare. It always will be. There's always complete catastrophe backstage. Nothing ever goes right. You're always on late or early, or the billing is all wrong. It's just awful. I said, you know what? I might do it, but we have to write down all these conditions because I'm tired of doing festivals. We're going to go on at dusk, which is 9 o'clock around there. And I said, we'll be the first band with lights because that's important. It's a subliminal thing. People see lights and they go, I really like this band compared to the rest of them. It's only because they've got lights going on. And it's a psychological thing that I've noticed. So I insisted on that. And he said, absolutely no problem.
In the event, the organisers demanded the band go on when it was still light, but Richie stuck to his guns.
People were yelling and screaming and threatening this and threatening that. And I just kept the door bolted and I'd have a few drinks playing the guitar. I was not going to go on.
Finally, when it was dark, Richie the musician went on stage.
You look fucking great from here. Really good.
And they were terrific on stage, though. Absolutely terrific. Richie's a spectacularly visual guitarist, he was. He ran around, he went back to the audience, threw his guitar around. And, of course, he did a bit of a Townsend sometimes and smashed the guitar at the end. But of all the guys in Deep Purple, it was Richie who was the most quixotic and mischievous.
And the quixotic and mischievous Richie was also on stage that night.
He's had enough. You know, he's playing away and you can hear, you know, he said he could hear this guy going, Limey, get back over there so I can, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And he killed the camera. It was brilliant showmanship.
Probably among the definitive moments of his kind of sense of spectacle and wanting to kind of turn it up to another notch or whatever.
Richie had plans for notching things up even further.
So I went to my roadie. I said, what I'm going to do is blow up the amplifiers. I said, what I want you to do is cover the amplifiers in petrol. I'll go across one side of the stage. You douse my marshals, dummy marshals, with petrol.
Ronnie Quinton, his beloved guitar tech, who is no longer with us, loaded way too much gunpowder into Richie's stuff. So when that, it blew Pacey's glasses off. I thought I was gonna die.
Exploded and like blew a hole in the stage. Pacey's glasses got blown off, so he can't see anything. It made some cameraman temporarily deaf. So, but it looked great.
Everybody was up and happy. Deep Purple just killed. I mean, they killed. Because, you know, this was still a bit of the transition into heavy metal, still kind of new. They really came through, let me tell you. They were good.
I was a total novice outside of the remarkable schooling of working men's clubs, and it's just a walk in the park, you know, after you've played Wingate Constitutional Club.
Yeah, he did a great job. You know, he pulled it off.
You're gonna love it! What?
And we had a helicopter. We were bundled into the helicopter and flown out. The police were coming to arrest us for blowing up the stage, being dangerous to all the, you know, the people, what have you. You know, it worked. And the idea was to upstage ELP, which I think we did.
That was probably one of the peak moments, certainly in economic terms and in terms of record breaking. that was one of the highlights of Deep Purple's career, because they played to this vast audience. I think it's in the Guinness Book of Records, some hundreds of thousands of people at this event.
I think it got better musically for them. You know, they continued, thank God, to progress musically. But I don't know that their popularity ever got, you know, bigger than Cal Jam 2.
Cal Jam had radically ramped up Richie's profile in America, but he was growing increasingly unhappy with the funky direction the band was taking.
Our first LP, Burn, was great. We had Mistreated, Burn, and it was all working. Now, the second record we made, Stormbringer, was good. But John, I think Ian, and even Dave, and of course, Glenn, were getting into this funk stuff. And I'm like, that's not me. It's got to be rock, blues. I don't want to be involved in that.
Me, John, and David wrote Holy Man together, and it was, you know, you can't do it right with the one you love. It was a group compositions. Hold On, you know, John came up with that great Fender Rhodes thing.
And with his Deep Purple colleagues unwilling to take the music in the direction he wanted, Richie now found someone who was, a singer named Ronnie James Dio.
That's when I did, I think, 16th Century Greasleys with Ronnie.
Actually recorded an album with Ronnie and the guys in Elf, and we didn't know about this.
And that turned out even better. I went, we've got to form a band, because this is just, it's just flowing, you know. There's none of this, no committee meetings, you know, and no briefcases involved and trying to get hold of people that were never around. Because Purple became a big business, the monster. So that's when I left and formed.
Richie's new band was named after the famous rock and roll Rainbow Bar and Grill on Sunset Boulevard in West Hollywood. He was his own boss at last.
Very exciting. We had Ronnie Dio, you know, he could come around and write a tune like that. I'd give him an idea, he'd put the top line to it, everything was fresh. You know, he had that ridiculous voice.
After the first album, Richie Blackmore's Rainbow became simply Rainbow.
We held auditions to put Rainbow together, and the 13th drummer was Cozy Powell, and he was the only one that could play a shuffle, and I was looking for some fire. And then Cozy came in and he did it.
He and Richie got on very well together. They both shared a love of, apart from rock and roll, of pranking, practical jokes. So. Of course, Cozy is quite a strong personality as well. So they respected each other and they liked each other. And that was really the basis of the success of Rainbow, I think, was this very powerful guitar player, incredibly strong drummer, and an enormously talented singer.
I think Cozy was a perfect foil for Richie, you know. And I know even Cozy found it hard at times. You know, Cozy used to tell me, it ain't easy, you know. But I think Cozy had such a respect for Richie and likewise the other way around. So, yeah, I think it was a great combination.
As a fan, it seemed like it was one more step into what was heavy metal. Certainly
with Dio singing, it was a remarkable step forward in that genre. I mean, a lot of people today, they listen to those records and they think that's where it really started, you know. It's almost as if he's playing more on those records. There's like more of Richie on those records.
It was a band in his own image, which Deep Purple were never. Deep Purple were partly his image and partly his creativity, but it belonged to everybody else. Rainbow was him. Rainbow is his definition, his moment of stepping into the spotlight and saying, this is me, this is where I want to go.
Cozy suddenly turned around, Cozy Powell, and said, you know who my favorite band is? It's ABBA. And we all went, oh, ABBA, how could you? As in, like, and he's like, yeah, I know, but that's my favorite band. Then I said, and mine. And then I think the bass player there went, and mine. And we suddenly all went, let's play some ABBA.
But unsurprisingly, no ABBA tracks made it onto the band's second album, Rainbow Rising.
Rainbow Rising was done in Munich in a studio, Arabella House, I think. Yeah. That was done quickly and done very well, and we had a good time playing it. By the time we got to Long Live Rock and Roll, things were getting... Ronnie was more into his girlfriend, you know, Wendy, and things were starting to slow down for ideas.
I don't think Rainbow ever equaled the success of Deep Purple, not in the public's perception or in the critic's mind, should we say. Despite the fact that it did produce some great music, it was a great live band. It was very entertaining and gave Richie Blackmore an opportunity to play with other people.
As far as the personnel changes go, you would need an abacus and a Cray computer to figure that one out. But you know, that family tree is tall, wide, and complicated. But through it all, there was Richie Blackmore.
And a Richie Blackmore who was still unpredictable and more than a little scary.
I've seen Richie lose it with someone. I better not say who it is, but you know, it was very explosive. Yeah, he doesn't suffer people to be fools. And I know Richie can be quite physical.
Richie got physical in Vienna in 1977.
We were playing in Austria to about 5,000, 7,000 people. A good show, and this little girl had come up to the front stage. She'd come up and kind of like handed up a note, you know, like, oh, I'm a big fan of the band or something like that, I don't know. And I'm just watching her, and the next minute she gets hit by this guy with a truncheon, and this bouncer. And of course I thought, he's not going to get away with that. So and I kicked him, you know. And I have strong legs, so of course I broke his jaw. He went down, blood, and I went, oh.
The resourceful stage crew hid Richie in a large flight case and pushed him towards the exit.
Every exit had police helmets and dogs, and they were about to push me up into the truck, into the lorry, and they insisted, opened it up. Of course, I just came out like a jack-in-the-box. Hi, everybody, you know. And then they locked me up for 4 days, which was pretty miserable, because the first night they would just like throw me on the floor and they wanted to beat the shit out of me because I just hit one of their guys. The consulate was of no use whatsoever. They just came and said, you've done a really bad thing. You might be here forever. It's like, that's a wake-up call. You know, I had a bad temper. My temper is not so bad anymore. Because I always think about that.
As well as his unscheduled jail visit, Richie now had to contend with a changing music market and an unchanging Ronnie. Look away from the sea. I can take
take you anywhere. Spend a visit with me. A chase with the wind.
Ronnie Dio and Richie Blackmore had a chemistry, but then as Blackmore got further into the Rainbow career, he saw himself as wanting to become a little bit more commercial. And Dio very much wanted to stay into the myth and dragons feel that he put forward in the lyrics, metaphorical rather than physical and actual. So the two of them went their separate ways, as we know.
But that isn't the whole story, as Richie now reveals.
Wendy apparently had told him, transatlantically, she said, called him up and said, Ronnie, Richie's on the front page of Circus magazine in America, and you two aren't. It should have been the three of us. That's what did it. And he said to me, he said, Cozy and I are not going to, just, we're not your sidekicks, and we're not standing for it. I don't want to work with someone that's that trivial, that ridiculous. I said, I can't work with this guy anymore. Just get him out of my life. And I remembered Graham Bonnet from the Marbles. And I said to Roger Glover, I said, what about trying to find him? I wonder what he's doing these days.
So I had to learn a Rainbow song because I knew nothing. I didn't know who Rainbow was. I had no clue. So I had to go out and buy albums and listen to the music. And I thought, well, I don't think this is really me. You know, I'm more into like R&B and pop kind of stuff.
That guy had an amazing voice. Could sing an F sharp above top C, and that was going some.
I remember going over there one afternoon, I heard this, Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow or something in the background. And it was off of my album. I said to Roger, why does he play that? He said he just loves your voice.
Richie also loved the idea of being more commercial.
We needed some radio play. We were a little bit too underground. So Since You've Been Gone got rid of that and we got it to number one, all of a sudden we were a big band. Yeah, we were riding high at that time. 1980 was our biggest moment, I think. We were quite big in England.
I love Since You've Been Gone. It's uncompromising and it has the perfect element of pop, which is you can sing it and it's in your head all day. And it's passionate. It has a real tug on your emotions. But Richie's in there. You know, Richie is powering the whole thing. And the solo is just brilliant. They did the immortal version of it.
Powered by their more commercial sound, Rainbow headlined the first ever Monsters of Rock Festival at Donington.
The critics hated us for whatever reason. You know, we were not a fashionable, on the front page of Rolling Stone type of band. You know, they just hated us. So, but the more they hated us, the more the people kind of went, we love them.
The fans may have loved Rainbow, but Richie was now having a problem with Graham Bonnet's hair.
Richie was 100% behind me being in the band, but 100% against my haircut.
It was a hair situation. You know, we were known to have denim people following us, and most people were kind of growing their hair long in those days, you know.
I went to get my hair cut in Sheffield really short. I mean, like, spiky and the whole thing. And I went on stage, and Richie hadn't seen me all day, and there he was playing his guitar, and, you know, the first song comes up, and he turns to me and he goes, you know, his mouth dropped.
He was singing to the audience and doing his bit, and I saw the back of the shaved neck, you know, that, you know, very, you know, cut hair, and I went, I'm just going to put my guitar across his head, but then I might. I'll be back in prison again, you know. I really was, like, so tempted just to take it off and go, whack.
Wanna touch ya, wanna feel ya, wanna feel your life.
Graham Bonnet and his hair lived to sing another day, but he had no luck persuading drummer Cozy Powell to stay on board. Powell didn't like the overtly commercial work the band was now doing.
And he was gone. And it was a very, very sad day. And he left the band, and later I did. That was my last show too, but I didn't know this at the time.
Graham Bonnet was a great singer, and Down to Earth is a thoroughly undervalued Rainbow album. But again, the problem was that Blackmore saw Bonnet not quite as having what it took in terms of personality to allow Blackmore to be himself.
Songwriting wasn't good the way we wanted it to. It was very slow. Nothing was happening. We had one song, and that was a song that Russ Ballard wrote, I Surrender, the song was called. And that's all we had. And so I left because Richie didn't come to rehearsals sometimes.
Graham left the band in 1980.
Like a month or so later, I thought, oh, what have I done? You know, I've left something that was great. I mean, it'd be nice to see him again, because I like him very much. He was a good friend, and he taught me a lot about the music I was suddenly pushed into, which I knew nothing about, and he was a great teacher.
Richie's friend Barry Ambrose suggested Jo Lynn Turner as a replacement for Graham Bonnet.
He said, listen to this record. I said, look, I said, Barry, I've heard so many singers, I can't hear anymore. I've got to get out of here. He said, just listen to this. And he played one track as I was leaving. And I went, actually, that sounds interesting. Who is this guy? And he said, guy from New Jersey.
I didn't know that he came to see me. I later found out when I got a phone call, living in Manhattan, lower Manhattan in the West Village, one room studio, I think you call it, and a mattress on the floor, money running out, and got a phone call from Barry Ambrosio, and he put Richie on the phone, and of course I complete disbelief, and he said, no, it's really me, and I said, well, all right, and they put the road manager on and told me train to take and to go out to the studio.
Playing in New Jersey, I went to see him, and I really liked his voice, very resonant, warm.
He came in with a couple of beers and said, you got the job if you want it, and I said, I want it, I need it, you know, and kept me there in the studio, and we just kept being creative, and Glover and I started to write more lyrics, and we finished the album, Difficult to Cure, like in a couple of weeks, I think, since my entrance.
Richie recorded three Rainbow albums with Jo Lynn Turner.
I think I wrote with Jo one of my favorite tunes, which is Street of Dreams. That to me was the ultimate Rainbow song. I love that song. You know, it come on the jukebox, I go, I'm proud of that. Because yeah, it was exactly where I wanted to go.
When we heard it, we knew we had something. You know, it was just chills up and down our, you know, we felt it. We said, man, this is deep. This is something.
And the fact that I could kind of write something that was poppy was something new for me. And I liked that groove. I just don't want to play crash, crash, crash for the sake of it. I've got to hear melody. Melody was always at the bottom of, for me, musically, where I was going.
While Richie had been developing Rainbow, his Deep Purple fans still wanted to see the classic Mark II lineup back together again.
1983, I think, the management called me up and said, you know, Purple wants to reform. And I said, well, I have to think about it. Rainbow were just now taking off really big in America. You know, we're really getting somewhere. We're doing big shows. And I don't know if I want it. It's so easy just to go back to Purple, you know. And I was like, eh. You know, and Gillan was really up for it. And I'm like, okay, you know, let's try it, you know.
I put up no fuss, no fight, no nothing like that. So I really felt good about it. And I also at that point in time, I had a solo album for Elektra Records and things were going well for me, you know, and Richie and I promised to get back together again anyway. So I had no compunction about it. I felt good about it.
Of course, there was money entered into it and the management's going, it's worth X amount. And I'm like, yeah, it might be an interesting idea. Okay, I'll try it. Cut a long story short. So we did it. You know, we had a good time. Perfect Strangers was a good record. And we all had a good time doing it. It was very comfortable being with Purple.
Perfect Strangers was a brilliant comeback album by Purple. It was a phenomenal performance because it got Mark II back together, but did it in a mid-80s fashion. They weren't living in the past. They weren't living in 1971, 72. They were actually being part of the modern hard rock world. And I think the relationship at the time between Gillan and Blackmore, which was always pointed out as being the problem, was quite amicable.
The amicable band toured in support of the album.
They were trying to say that Bruce Springsteen was doing the biggest business. The biggest business was us and Grateful Dead, then Bruce Springsteen. I don't know what people see in Bruce Springsteen whatsoever. I've never got that.
The ticket sales showed that the old magic was still there, but so were the old rivalries with Gillan.
I put it down to he wanted to kind of maybe steer the band, and I was steering the band. So I think it was that more than anything. Of course, it worked. I thought, you know, Perfect Strangers worked. You know, everybody was on form. We played. It worked. But we should have stopped right there. And then we did House of Blue Light. To me, was disastrous.
And the relationship with Ian was soon back in the disaster zone too.
He'd lost his voice completely. And we're going, what are we going to do? And I was always already disgusted with Ian. We weren't getting along. So to me, I was like, well, we've got to get another singer. I mean, this is just a joke.
By 1987, Richie had played with scores of musicians in dozens of bands. A self-confessed wind-up merchant who thrived on conflict. The Uneasy Rider was about to meet his match. Appropriately enough, on the football field.
I used to have my roadie call up radio stations and say, Deep Purple would like to do a game of soccer against you if you feel like playing a charity.
It's kind of my fairy tale Cinderella story because I was working for this radio station on Long Island. I was interning there, and apparently somebody from Deep Purple had called up. So the DJs came out and they played, and Purple showed up. It was Richie and Roger. He signed an autograph for me, and he looked up at me and he said, in that very classy English accent that I'm sure you're familiar with, you're a very beautiful girl. And I went, oh, that's nice. And that would have been my Richie Blackmore story, that he said I was beautiful. And that was enough at that point. And I said thank you, and I walked off the field. And he sent his roadies through the crowd to find out who I was and asked me to meet him at a pub later.
Candice Knight was a musical New Yorker who'd been modeling from age 12. She had her own radio rock show and had studied communications at New York Institute of Technology.
And Richie had the most brilliant, proper, upper-class English way of breaking the ice, right? He was taking off his soccer cleats and his dirty, mud-filled, sweaty soccer socks, and he balled one up and threw it right in my face.
That's the way to get a girl.
And I didn't worry about my nails after that anymore because I thought this is ridiculous. And we just, it was, after that, there was really nothing that totally relaxed the whole entire environment.
Spell, yeah.
He said to me that when I walked into the room, meeting him at that pub that afternoon, he said, you know, I felt like when you walked in that an old friend had walked into the room. Like, it felt like home.
Richie now had an ally who put him at ease. Soon their shared interest in medieval life and music was to take center stage. But first, a replacement had to be found for Gillan. Richie approached his rainbow vocalist, Joe Lynn Turner.
At first, Joe hesitated on it. You know, and Pacey's going, well, he was in Rainbow. It's like, yeah, well, got any other ideas? And John's like, yeah, sounds great. So we tried him out, he worked, and then he was in.
He started playing Hey Joe. I grabbed the mic, started singing it. Never even said hello to John or Ian at that point. Finished the song, and then there were some handshakes. And John started to play this keyboard bit, which later became on the Purple album, The Cut Runs Deep. And I started singing the exact lyric, as Richie always called it, I had a magic bag of lyrics. And I would just pull out a lyric that suited this and sing a melody. And it was the exact lyric. There it was. Bam, there's the song. So John and Ian were convinced that I should be the guy.
But it was to be Joe Lynn's only album with Deep Purple. He left the band in 1992.
There was a lot of frustration going on, a lot of unhappiness. The guys, I believe it was Ian and John, and I say this with all love and respect, felt they needed Ian Gillan back in the band, and Richie was staunch about me staying in the band, and there was and there just wasn't any way that I could deal with the emotions that were happening. So. I think I quit and got fired at the same time, whatever, doesn't really matter. But it was nerve-wracking and just turmoil and very stressful.
Meanwhile, Richie and Candice had moved in together.
By 91, I had moved in with you.
Yeah. She'd moved in, but I didn't know who she was. I just knew there was a great female in the house. I was like, hey, I'm not going to knock it.
I locked my door every night. I bolted it. I was on tour as his girlfriend, yes. But I, at our parties at the house, when we have parties at our house, everybody has to contribute something. So if Richie's going to bring out the acoustic guitar and play for people, he wants everybody to give a little bit of themselves. So he doesn't care if it's a speech about the Alamo, right, or tap dance, or a song, or something, anything. So when I was at the parties with Richie, he and I would be doing songs together. That's how he first got me singing with him.
The first song they wrote together was a wedding anniversary present for Candice's parents.
This is something that Rainbow would never have done. They'd play a waltz. Go.
Be here mine tonight. We'll travel through all our memories in our own little place. In time, you've always been mine.
What we didn't see.
Through the years, that's very subtle. I feel your love beside me through the laughter and the tears. You've conquered all my fears.
First song we wrote.
Be Mine Tonight. That's what kind of what makes me laugh when people say, oh, she must have made him do Renaissance music, because you don't make him do anything. You never make Ritchie Blackmore do anything. Everything that he, his choice of direction is solely up to him. And I feel like I'm really on a journey that he's kind of led the way and taken, you know, he's the captain of this journey. I'll be the co-captain. That's fine, you know.
Ritchie would make one more album with Deep Purple. With Joe Lynn Turner gone, the band put down backing tracks and looked for a singer.
The band thinks that we should get Gillan back and the record label. They sent the tapes of Ian singing like three songs that we'd done, three backing tracks.
he'd put his voice over, and I'm like, this is absolutely dreadful. This is rotten to the core. This is just rubbish. That's how bad it was to me. It was deadly. And then he said, well, how much would you take to work with that? I said, well, it really doesn't come into it.
The album was made with Gillan on vocals, then the record company wanted the band to go on tour to promote it. It was also the 25th anniversary of Mark II. Richie demanded a vast fee, thinking it would be refused, but his strategy backfired.
I went, you know what? I'll take X amount, which was over the top, just to get them off my back so I could look for another singer. And they came back with BMG. Okay, I'll pay you that if you work with Gillan. And I went, now I'm caught. I got halfway through the tour and I can't take this anymore. You know, I'm selling my soul here. Right? This is awful. This is dreadful shit. You know? Ian and I had a showdown with Spaghetti, and it was in Cleveland. Jim had picked up my food from catering, and Ian had gone, "Who's that for?" And Jim goes, "Well, it's Rich's food." He said, "Let me add some ketchup to it." And of course he put ketchup all over it. And I went up to him and I said, "Did you do this to my food?" And he went, "Yeah." And with that, I saw John Law go, and they all parted. It was like a high noon. You know? I went, "Really? Hmm." And then I got it and I went right in his face.
Well, Battle Rages On was the first time we played in Czechoslovakia, and he asked me to sing the just like a vocal part, just Oz, you know, like background Oz.
Candice was singing off stage and out of sight, which confused some local reviewers.
There was a Czechoslovakian paper who had written a review and said that John Lord must have sampled a female vocal into his keyboards because they could clearly hear some girl singing. No!
I knew if I went to the management and said, "I want to leave the Bruce Payne management," that would go no further. And I'd be back at square one. So I thought, I'm going to have to write a letter to the band to explain how I feel. And I've got to leave. And I will not be going to Japan with them.
Richie played his last concert with Deep Purple in Helsinki on 17th of November 1993.
So we went back to the hotel and we proceeded to say goodbyes. I think I said goodbye to Ian Pace. That was it. Everybody else just ran away. Pacey came up to me and said, "Make some good decisions." And left. And Candy was with me. And I think John was too embarrassed to say anything.
John went right up to his room.
It was such a relief.
Richie reformed Rainbow, now with Doogie White on vocals, and made one final album with them too, Stranger in Us All.
I think Rainbow probably gave him a little bit more freedom in that regard. And then the album that I did certainly did, you know, give him more freedom.
This freedom also enabled Richie and Candice to develop their writing partnership. And the album included one of the first songs they wrote together, Ariel. Yeah.
The Blackmore Sight thing kind of happened when we were doing the last Rainbow record. We would kind of get together as sort of a jam night thing at the end of the evening when we were recording at Longview Farm in Massachusetts. And we would just kind of like start, you know, sitting around the fire, and they would just kind of jam, and they would do stuff, Renaissance stuff like Green Sleeves, that sort of thing.
When I was 10, there was this kid singing Green Sleeves, and I was really taken by that mode. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Just, it was very reminiscent of another time. Almost spiritual, I thought. Just seem to go straight to my soul, and I've always been that way. If I hear medieval music, I'm immediately come alive.
Ritchie and Candice formed Blackmore's Night and made their first album, Shadow of the Moon, in 1997.
His escape from the stress and pressures of that rock and roll world wound up being just to sit and just open up on acoustic. And just really kind of look into the fireplace and just go someplace else. And that's where, I think that's where the beginning of our project happened, really. He often says that if you listen to Smoke on the Water, you'll hear medieval fourths and fifths, the modal scales of that era. So that was going back to 1971, so that was in him there as well. And then, of course, fast forward to Rainbow, and you've got everything from Temple of the King, 16th century Greensleeves. So it's a lot of medieval flair in a lot of those songs.
We're still scratching the surface. It's like, you know, I still feel there's so far to go with it. Whereas with the others, I felt we're at the end. One of the best compliments I had was, I hate medieval and Renaissance music, but I love your music. And I went, that's a big compliment, much more than you think. With our show, it's more the audience is part of us, yeah. And we're there to, you know, to entertain them. We're not there to show off and wiggle our hips. Yeah.
Since that first album in 1997, Ritchie and Candice have made another 9 together.
So the sisters smiled to themselves, and they whispered as they showed.
When Ritchie plunged into medieval music, it wasn't so much as a surprise as a sort of natural course of events.
Superstition play the air. Sparks fly as the fires burn at midnight. Stars are out and magic is here. Stars are out and magic is here.
I also feel that urge, because somehow when you've done all the big heavy stuff, it's always attractive, but you want to explore the other side.
The minstrels, you know, the peasant kind of walking from town to town, just telling the news from the last town, and a bit of gossip, plays a few tunes. That's who I relate to.
That doesn't mean that some of the songs don't still include modern rock influences.
It's like me. I love what I do. I truly love what I do. And I can hear that Ritchie loves what he does. And I salute him for it.
Sweet William Boone,
cares just badly for the love of Barbara Allen.
True musicians, people who don't have a choice, you know, they just love music and that's the path they follow. If he wants to switch into something else, that's because his inner musical inspiration pulls him there, and true musicians are almost slaves to that.
The music may be historically inspired, but Ritchie's electric guitar virtuosity is still very much part of their medieval journey.
He sees himself, I think, as the quiet musketeer. You know, he's rather romantic, sort of heroic, dashing figure.
I never feel like we're done. We're just like, we're still learning so much about the instruments and the songs and ourselves, really.
I have entered through the gates to see the queen and her binary. Playing chess with the king of spades. It's all part of that fantasy.
Takes me back to another life. It might be a past life, you know, reincarnation. I just loved to be in the 1500s without getting the plague and having central heating and a satellite dish. Whereas if I hear rock and roll, I'm like, I've heard it all before, Christ. It all ended about 30 years ago. Everybody now is so generic. How long can you keep flogging something, you know?
It's nearly 50 years since the young schoolboy from Heston decided to show his teachers they were wrong about him by achieving true excellence on the guitar and to make good on the faith his parents had shown in him by putting the music first.
Of all the great guitar players, he was the one that people knew least about, I think, and that was partly his own doing.
His confidence was overwhelming. It was frightening. Inspiring and frightening.
I think Ritchie would be remembered as somebody wild and untamed to the end of his days, and I think that's a magnificent thing to be.
I can buy a Strat, you can buy a Strat, right? We can get a Marshall, he can get a Marshall, but none of us ever wind up sounding like Ritchie.
A high degree of being completely in the moment, impulsive, and just being kind of true to himself and true to what his perception of that moment was in a live situation.
He's not an extrovert. He's very much an introvert. And when you have somebody like that, they create brilliantly, but there's also a lot of depth that they're always constantly dealing with.
There is nothing better than just sitting with the guitar and emoting. I can be in Hawaii and everybody's on water skiing and things. I'm watching the dolphins, but I'm in my room just looking out, looking at the horizon. So I've got to be playing. That's my friend, you know, who I'm kind of emoting with.
My gut feeling is that Ritchie's probably at his best when he tends to actually live out the, you know, the rather quiet, withdrawn, artistic and thoughtful person that I think really is what he's ultimately about.
You know, when people get things all in perspective, Ritchie will be right there as one of the cornerstones of what rock and roll is today.
There's a long list of rock guitar players that wouldn't exist without Ritchie Blackmore.
You know, there are people who enter this band thing for lots of different reasons, for money and for fame and for the chicks. It seems to me Ritchie Blackmore entered into this for the music.
And for the two people who encouraged him to take guitar lessons in the first place. His mother, and especially his father.
He came to the Albert Hall when we did the orchestra thing, Deep Purple in the orchestra. He loved that. I think then he suddenly realized, well, I think my son's doing something here. 5,000 people and there's an orchestra.
If that childhood photograph was taken today, they'd probably all be smiling.